So let's discuss about now the concepts of pharmacodynamics. Okay, now what do we mean by the word pharmacodynamics? Pharma means drug and dynamic means effect produced by the drug. Okay, effect produced, or you can write mechanisms of action of a drug. Mechanism of action of a drug. One basic question arises that how does a drug produces effect inside our body? Now remember, drug produces effect in our body when the drug binds to its target. Hence, when the drug will bind to its target, the effect will be produced. Hence, in pharmacodynamics, we will discuss about three things. The types of drugs. Here, drugs are also known as ligands. So, types of drugs or ligands. The types of targets. And how do we measure the effect? We measure the effect by a graph known as dose response curve. Okay, dose response curve. So these are the three concepts you have to remember in pharmacodynamics. So let's start with the first one, that is targets. Okay, now if you talk about targets, remember targets are of four types. Targets are of four types. They are RICE. So these are the protein targets. The first is receptors, which is present on the cells. Then we have ion channels, especially voltage gated ion channel. Then we have carrier proteins, which are also known as transporters. And lastly, we have enzymes. Okay, and among them, the expected question comes from receptors. Now, if you talk about receptors, there are four kinds of receptors on a cell, four types. Among these four types, the three are present on cell membrane, 1, 2, and 3. And the fourth one is present inside the cell. So there are four types of receptors. Okay, now let's discuss each of this receptor. The first receptor, which is present on the cell membrane, is known as ionotropic receptor, which is also known as ligand-gated ion channel. Ligand-gated ion channel. So it is just like a rose flower. It's a pentameric rosette type of shape, and when it opens, the ions moves inside. Now, what are the examples of the ligands produced in our body which act through ionotropic receptors? We will write, first is acetylcholine, nicotinic receptors. It is not muscarinic, it is nicotinic receptors. You will write serotonin, 5-HT3 receptors. Then you will write glutamate receptors, like NMDA receptors, AMPA receptors, kinate receptors. Lastly, you will write the receptor of GABA known as GABA-A. GABA-A chloride channel. So these are the examples of ionotropic receptors. Now the second type of receptor present on the cell membrane is known as, that second type of receptor which is present on cell membrane is known as GPCR, G protein coupled receptors. They are also known as metabotrophic receptors. Why? Because they act with the help of second messengers. Okay, they act with the help of second messenger. If you talk about their shape, they have two parts. One is a receptor part, which is a 7 transmembrane protein. And it is linked to a protein known as G protein. So that is why it is known as G protein coupled receptor. This G protein has three subunit, alpha subunit, beta subunit, and gamma subunit. And this alpha subunit in a normal state or a resting state contains GDP. And in active state, it gets converted into GTP. And when it gets converted into GTP, it donates its phosphate group, this G protein, and it will lead to phosphorylation of proteins. Now, depending upon the phosphorylation of protein, these G proteins are of various type like GS, GQ, GI, and etc. Many others are also there. If it is of GS type, remember, it activates one enzyme known as adenyl cyclase inside the cell, or sometimes guanyl cyclase. If it is GQ type, it activates phospholipase C. If it is GI type, it inhibit adenyl cyclase. Now these enzymes, they increase or decrease second messengers inside the cell. So if it is adenyl cyclase, remember it increases cyclic AMP inside the cell. If it is guanyl cyclase, it increases cyclic GMP inside the cell, GS type. If it is GQ type, by phospholipase enzyme, it activates IP3-DAG, inositol, triphosphate, diacylglycerol. And if it is of imidacloprid cyclate, it decreases cyclic AMP. Now these molecules, cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, inositol, triphosphate, diacylglycerol, they are known as second messenger. These molecules, they act with the help of protein. Second messengers, cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, IP3 DAG, and cyclic AMP, they produce effect inside the cell by a pathway known as protein kinase pathway. They activate one pathway inside the cell known as protein kinase pathway. If it is cyclic AMP, it will activate protein kinase A pathway. Cyclic GMP, protein kinase G pathway. If it is IP3, it activates calcium calmodulin pathway. That is why sometimes calcium level will increase, and calcium will increase the calmodulin pathway known as third messenger. DAG, it is known as protein kinase C pathway. And if it is cyclic AMP, it will reduce cyclic AMP level. Reduction in cyclic AMP level opens potassium channel. Potassium will move out of the cell and it will hyperpolarize the cell. Now the third type of receptor, what are the examples of GPCR? We will write the examples of GPCR are, you will write acetylcholine, muscarinic receptor is a GPCR. So the receptor of acetylcholine is muscarinic receptor, is GPCR, G protein coupled receptor, nicotinic is inotropic. You'll write rest all other serotonin receptor 5-HT1 to 5-HT7. They all are GPCR except 5-HT3. You'll write GABA B. GABA A is inotropic, GABA B is GPCR. But what are the other receptors? You'll write all receptors of autocoids like histamine are GPCR. All pancreatic hormones like glucagon and somatostatin are GPCR. Okay, but not insulin. Insulin we will discuss will be of third type. All the hormones of hypothalamus are GPCR. All the hormones of pituitary are GPCR except two. So you will write the exceptions are insulin is not a GPCR. And among pituitary hormones, remember growth hormone and prolactin are also not GPCR. They will be the third type of receptor. And apart from this, you will write opioid receptors are also GPCR. Vasopressin receptors are also GPCR. So it is the largest family of receptor we have. Now the third receptor which is present on the surface of cell is known as growth receptor, known as protein kinase receptor. Protein kinase receptor, also known as growth receptor. Now depending upon the kinase enzyme, it is of different type. It could be tyrosine kinase. Remember, tyrosine kinase is acted upon by insulin and various growth factors. It could be JAK-STAT pathway, Janus kinase pathway. So growth hormone, prolactin, cytokines, and interferons and erythropoietin, they act through JAK-STAT pathway. Okay, so they are responsible for cell growth. And the last receptor which is present inside the cell is fourth, known as intracellular receptors. Intracellular receptors. If you talk about intracellular receptors, we will write upwards. Intracellular receptors could be of two type. Intracellular receptors could be intracytoplasmic, or it could be intranuclear. So it could be intracytoplasmic, it could be intranuclear. So both of them, they act through DNA. Intracytoplasmic, they translocate into the nucleus later on, and they activate transcription of gene. So intranuclear, you will write for example TAPE, that is thyroid hormone T3 and T4. A for vitamin A. P for PPAR receptor, peroxisomal proliferator activating receptor. E for estrogen. So all lipid soluble hormones, they will act through intracellular receptors. Intracellular receptors, sometimes they are also known as nuclear receptor as well. Now intracytoplasmic, remember all steroidal hormones in our body except estrogen, they act through intracytoplasmic, like glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid, testosterone, progesterone. And lastly, we will write vitamin D3 or calcitriol. It also acts through intracytoplasmic receptors. So this is all about the receptors you must remember. So keeping this thing in mind, let's discuss the first question. All of the following drugs act by ligand activated or modulated membrane ion channels. So ion channel means ionotropic receptors. Excepts are, the first is acetylcholine. The answer is absolutely right. Serotonin, absolutely right. GABA A chloride channel, remember benzodiazepines act. Hence the answer is nitric oxide. Remember, nitric oxide does not act on receptor. Nitric oxide goes inside the cell and it can directly stimulate one enzyme known as guanyl cyclase. So nitric oxide does not act on any receptors. Let's come to now, we will skip a question. So let's talk about now question number two. Okay, let's talk about now question number two. So if you talk about question number two, there we are discussing about the concept of spare receptors. Now let's see, let's understand what do we mean by the word spare receptors. Okay, now if you talk about spare receptors, let's understand the concept. Suppose this is a cell, and on this cell, suppose there are 100 receptors. There are 100 receptors. Now the point is, when the drug will come or ligand will come, if the ligand will act on the receptor, remember, ligand need not to activate all the receptors on the cell. Remember, to produce maximum effect, only few receptors must be activated. Let's say if this ligand will bind only to 10 receptors, you can say maximum effect can be produced. So what about the rest 90 receptors? These rest 90 receptors are known as spare receptors. Okay. Now these remaining receptors on which drug usually do not act, they have no role in the effect of a drug, effect inside the cell, they are known as spare receptors. Now these spare receptors, remember, even if the drug is not there, they are always present on the surface of cell. They never go inside the cell, they are never degraded, they are always present on the surface of cell. Now the point is, in the absence of drug, remember, they always remain on the surface of cell. Now the second point is that drug usually do not interact with this spare receptor. The only few amount of receptors are interacted by the drug and the maximum effect is produced. Now there are two terminologies which you must remember. Okay, so you must remember. So spare receptor do not depend upon the drug. Now the next point is, suppose there are two terms, one is known as EC, one is known as KD. EC stands for effective concentration. Okay, effective concentration means that how much should be the concentration of the drug that must bind to the receptor to produce an effect. Okay, suppose if we say that 10 molecules of our drugs are required to produce maximum effect. Can we say that 10 molecules of the drug must interact with 10 molecules of receptors and this 10 molecules can produce maximum effect? So what about rest 90%? They are spare receptors. Okay. Now if you talk about, let's change this EC into EC50. EC50 means 50% of the effect. So can we say here we require only 5 drug molecule which must interact with 5 receptors? Okay, so EC50 means how much receptors must be occupied by the drug so that 50% of the effect is produced. So in this case, let's say we have assumed 10 receptor occupancy will produce 100% response, 5 receptor occupancy will produce 50% response. Now what is KD? KD is the concentration at which 50% of receptors are occupied. 50% of the receptors are occupied. So if we will occupy 50% of the receptors, this is known as KD. Can we say that in cases of this example, in cases of this spare receptor, to produce 50% of the effect, we require only 5 receptors? And the KD is the concentration of the drug at which 50% of the receptors are occupied. It is known as KD. So in cases of spare receptor, remember effective concentration is always very less as compared to the KD of a drug. KD is that concentration at which 50% of the receptors are occupied. But remember, to produce maximum response, we don't need occupancy of all the receptors. Rest all other receptors are known as spare receptors. So let's, keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about this question. Which of the following statement about spare receptor is most correct? Now, spare receptor, in the absence of drug, they are sequestered into the cytoplasm. The answer is absolutely false. They always remain on the surface of cell. Spare receptors may be detected by finding that the drug receptor interaction lasts longer than intracellular effect. The answer is absolutely false. Spare receptor do not interact with the drug. Spare receptor influence the maximal efficacy of a drug receptor systems. The answer is absolutely false. Remember, spare receptor, they do not interact with the drug. Even if they are not interacting with the drug, if only some amount of the receptors are occupied, a cell can produce maximum effect. So spare receptor do not influence maximum effect of a drug. Spare receptor activate effector machinery of a cell without need of a drug. Yes, this could be sometimes true. This is absolutely false again. Why? Because spare receptor, they do not function. They will only function when the drug will interact. Now the last point, if you see, spare receptor may be detected by finding that EC50 is smaller than KD of a drug or an agonist. The answer is absolutely true. Because EC50 is the concentration at which 50% of the response will be produced. Let's say if you will occupy only 5 receptors, 50% of the effect will be produced. But if you will occupy 50% of the all receptor, including spare receptor, this is known as KD of a drug. So in cases of spare receptor, EC50 is always very less than KD of a drug. Okay. So the true statement in this question is the last one. Now, which of the following most accurately describes the transmembrane signaling process of growth hormone? We already discussed that growth hormone acts through JAK-STAT pathway. Okay. Now, neurotransmitter noradrenaline, adrenaline and dopamine. Remember, these molecules are known as catecholamines. And they mediate sympathetic nervous system. And remember, in sympathetic nervous system, there are two types of receptor, alpha and beta. And remember, all the receptors of sympathetic nervous system, they are GPCR, G protein coupled receptor. Alpha is further divided into alpha 1 and alpha 2. Beta is further divided into beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. Now just remember that this alpha 1 receptor is of GQ type. It acts by inositol triphosphate pathway and DAG pathway. Alpha 2 is GI type. And beta 1, beta 2, beta 3 are of GS type. They increase cyclic AMP. Alpha 1, it decreases cyclic AMP. GQ, it increases IP3 DAG. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. So let's talk about this question number 4. So the question number 4 is, adrenaline, they act through which receptor? We know that GPCR, if you remember the structure of GPCR we had discussed, the structure of GPCR was, it was having a receptor portion, which is having a 7 transmembrane loop. And it was attached to a G protein, alpha, beta, gamma subunit of G protein. So the answer for this question is C, 7 transmembrane receptors. Okay. Now let's come to question 5. If there is GS alpha subunit gain of function, this will result in, as we know that GS type increases, act by increasing cyclic AMP level. So the answer is D, cyclic AMP. Okay. So the answer is D, increase in cyclic AMP. Now let's talk about question number 6. Which of the following statement best describes the mechanism of action of insulin? We know that insulin acts through protein kinase receptor. And which type of protein kinase receptor? We know it will act through tyrosine kinase receptor, which is present on the cell surface, cell membrane, and it leads to cell division. That is why insulin is a major anabolic hormone of our body. So just try to find the answer of tyrosine. So insulin bind to cytoplasmic receptor? The answer is absolutely no. Okay, it is not an intracellular receptor. Insulin binds to a molecule on the outer surface of plasma membrane and hormone response complex and activate adenyl cyclase through GPCR. No, it is not a G protein coupled receptors. Insulin enters into the cell and causes release of calcium. No, it doesn't enter into the cell. So let's talk about this option number C. Insulin binds to transmembrane receptor at the outer surface. It's absolutely true. On plasma membrane and activate tyrosine kinase, that is cytosolic domain of this receptor. The answer is absolutely true. So it acts through tyrosine kinase type of receptors. So the answer is C. Now, action of alpha subunit of G protein. Okay, the action of self alpha subunit, remember, in the resting state, suppose this is a G protein, in the resting state this alpha subunit contains GDP. Okay, now in active form this alpha subunit separates and beta gamma separates, and this GDP gets converted into GTP. Okay, and it produces effect inside the cell. Why? Because this GTP will be breakdown into GDP, and again this G protein will be converted into its resting state. So the function of alpha subunit is, it causes breakdown of GTP into GDP. Why? Because it has dephosphorylase activity inside the cell. Okay, it leads to breakdown. So alpha subunit of G protein is the active subunit of G protein. Okay, so try to remember, this is the function of alpha subunit. Now, all are second messengers, except we have already discussed IP3. DAG was a second messenger. Cyclic AMP was also a second messenger. Guanyl cyclase is not a second messenger. It rather increases the formation of a second messenger known as cyclic GMP. Okay, so guanyl cyclase is not a second messenger. All known effects of cyclic AMP in eukaryotic cells occurs through, we have already discussed, all these second messenger, they activate protein kinase pathway. Okay, they all activate protein kinase pathway. All of the following agents act by intracellular receptor. The answer is thyroid hormone. Yes, they act through intranuclear receptor. Vitamin D, yes, it acts through intracytoplasmic receptor. Steroid, yes, intracytoplasmic, not insulin. Insulin acts through tyrosine kinase receptor, which is present on the surface of a cell. Okay, now which of the following has a cytoplasmic receptor? Try to find a steroidal hormone, that is glucocorticoid, cortisol. Okay, cortisol. Okay, now G protein coupled receptor is metabotrophic receptor. We have already discussed, because they act through with the help of second messengers. Okay, receptor mediated action is not seen with. The answer is antacids. Antacids, they do not bind to any receptor, they rather bind to the HCl, which is floating inside the stomach. Okay, now increase in cyclic AMP is caused by GS type of receptor, and we have already discussed that beta receptors are of GS type. All of the following drugs act on ionic channel except nicotine. We have already discussed, yes, the acetylcholine nicotinic receptor is ionic channel. Insulin, no. Geblancamide, yes, because it is a sulfonylurea. Remember, it opens potassium channel on the surface of beta cells. Sorry, it will close potassium channel on the surface of beta cells of pancreas, and it releases insulin. Diazepam, yes, it acts on GABA A chloride channel. So the answer is again insulin, because insulin act on tyrosine kinase receptors. Pharmacodynamic means, it means the mechanism of action of a drug. Okay, so this is about the receptors. Now let's talk about the ligand part, drug part or ligand part. In ligand part, we will be discussing various types of agonists now and antagonists. Okay, now let's talk about what are the different types of agonists we have. Now, what is an agonist? Agonist is any molecule which has a very high affinity for its target or receptor. For its target or its receptor. But now, how much effect it will produce, efficacy, that means how much effect it will produce, on this basis we will divide agonist into various type. If agonist produces 100% of the effect, or you will write plus one effect, it is known as full agonist. And if it will produce zero effect or no effect, okay, it is known as antagonist. Now remember, instead of the word efficacy or effect, we can also write a term intrinsic activity. So what is full agonist? Full agonist is a molecule which has high affinity for the target and it produces plus one intrinsic activity. Similarly, antagonist is a molecule which has high affinity for the target, but it has zero intrinsic activity. Then if it will produce partial effect, it is known as 0 to 1, it is known as partial agonist. So partial agonist will produce sub-maximal or low intrinsic activity. And lastly, we have inverse agonist. Inverse agonist will produce minus one effect. It will produce opposite effect or negative intrinsic activity. Okay. So these are the examples of agonist and antagonist. That is why agonist, they will just block the site. Now, if you talk about this antagonist in great detail, if you talk about these antagonists, remember antagonists are of various types. The first antagonist is known as physical antagonist. Now, physical antagonist, it will bind with agonist. So here the antagonist will bind with agonist and prevents its action by physical bond. So this bond will be physical bond. Okay. The classical example is activated charcoal. Then we have chemical antagonist. Chemical antagonist will bind to agonist and prevents its action, but it will bind with chemical bond like acid-base reaction or covalent bond. The classical example is, we will write antacids. Antacids, they are basic molecule. They will bind with HCl present inside the stomach. Okay. Similarly, we can write heparin versus protamine. Okay. Similarly, we will write monoclonal antibodies. Antibody antigen reaction is a chemical reaction. You can write sugammadex. Remember, sugammadex is a antidote for skeletal muscle relaxant known as rocuronium, v-curonium. So we will discuss this question. Then we have physiological antagonist. Physiological antagonist, it will not bind with agonist. Rather, physiological antagonist will produce opposite effect. It will produce opposite effect by binding to different target or different receptor. Let's take an example of physiological antagonist. Suppose histamine act on H1 receptor in bronchus and produces bronchoconstriction, and adrenaline will act on beta-2 receptor on bronchus and produce bronchodilatation. So they are acting on their different receptor H1 and beta-2. But if you are seeing the effect which is produced is exactly opposite, this is an example of physiological antagonist. So other examples are calcitonin versus parathyroid hormone. We can also write other examples like insulin versus glucagon. Growth hormone, insulin produces hypoglycemia. Growth hormone, glucagon produces hyperglycemia. Calcitonin produces hypocalcemia. Parathyroid hormone produces hypercalcemia. Similarly, thromboxane A2 produces platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction. PGI2 or prostacyclin produces inhibit platelet aggregation and produces vasodilatation. So these are the various examples of physiological antagonist. Now, the last one we have is pharmacological antagonist. Now, pharmacological antagonists, they are also known as blockers, because they will block the site, they will block the target where agonist is binding. So they inhibit the binding of agonist to their target. Now, these pharmacological antagonists, they can be of two type. They can be of competitive type, competitive antagonist, and non-competitive antagonist. Okay, they are of two types, competitive and non-competitive antagonists. So we will discuss about these two antagonists or pharmacological antagonists shortly in great detail. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the question number one. That is, sugammadex is a new drug. It acts as a reverse the action of rocuronium and other skeletal muscle relaxant like v-curonium also. It appears to be interact directly with rocuronium molecule and not with rocuronium receptor. Now, which of the following terms describe best? It's an example of, we know that physical and chemical antagonists, they directly interact with the agonist. Okay. Physiological will go to some different site and produce different response, opposite response. Pharmacological antagonists, they will block the target. Okay. So the classical answer for sugammadex, we have already written, is chemical antagonist. Okay, so Sugammadex is a classical example of chemical antagonist. Now, which of the following best describe antagonist that indirectly that interacts directly with agonist and not at all or incidentally with the receptor? So this antagonist will directly interact with agonist. So we have two options. One is chemical and second is physical antagonist. The answer here is again chemical antagonist. They both bind with chemical bonds. Now, leukotriene produces bronchoconstriction in patient with asthma. When given with albuterol, albuterol produces bronchodilatation. It is an example of beta 2 agonist. So albuterol act on beta 2 receptor and produces bronchodilatation. Leukotriene act on LT1 receptor and produces bronchoconstriction. So as we can see, just opposite responses produced by acting on different receptor. This is a classical example of physiological antagonist. Okay, so exactly opposite response by acting on different receptor is physiological antagonist. Now, which of the following best describes a drugs that blocks the action of epinephrine at its vascular blocks? See, blocker word is coming. At its vascular alpha receptors by occupying epinephrine receptor. So first, it should be an example of pharmacological antagonist. And we had discussed that pharmacological antagonist is blocking the same target or the same receptor. They are of two type, competitive and non-competitive. So let's talk about now pharmacological antagonism. Okay, pharmacological antagonism, it is also known as blockers. Now they are of two type, one is competitive, second is non-competitive blocker. So first is competitive blocker, second is non-competitive. So let's discuss this concept in great detail. So suppose this is the target and here agonist is binding. Agonist comes and bind here. What happens in cases of competitive antagonist? Competitive antagonist also bind to the same target. So in cases of competitive antagonist, remember the binding site is same. Same site. They both compete, agonist and antagonist. They both will have same structure. And remember, if we will increase the dose of agonist, we can overcome the effect of antagonist because there is both competition out there. This property is known as surmountable effect. Surmountable means if we can increase the dose of agonist, we can overcome the effect of antagonist. Okay, so we can produce that same level of response by increasing the dose of agonist. This property is known as, you will write, Vmax will remain normal. But the dose required to produce that effect, the agonist dose which is required to produce that effect, Km will increase. Okay, now second is non-competitive antagonist. It is a different molecule acting on different site. Different site, this different site is known as allosteric site. It will have different structure. Now when this antagonist will bind here, it will modify the target. So it leads to modification of target. So if we will keep on increasing the dose of agonist, we cannot produce that same level of response ever again. So it is non-surmountable. Okay, so if you cannot produce that same level of response never again, the Vmax will always remain less. It can never increase. And what about Km? There is no point of increasing the dose. The Km will remain normal. What is this Vmax and Km? Vmax and Km are known as Michaelis-Menten constant. Michaelis-Menten constant. For complete details of Vmax and Km, you can refer to the videos. There we have discussed what is Vmax, what is Km, how do we determine, etc. So this is the difference between competitive and non-competitive antagonists. So keep this thing in mind. Let's see the question number 4. Which of the following best describes the action of a drug that blocks the epinephrine at its vascular alpha receptor by occupying epinephrine target or epinephrine receptor? So the classical answer is competitive antagonist. Okay, so the classical answer is, the main answer is competitive antagonist is the right answer for this question number 4. Let's come to question number 5. True statement regarding inverse agonist. So inverse agonist will bind to the receptor. Yes, it will bind to the receptor. It is coming in all. And we know that inverse agonist produces negative response, minus 1 response. If you remember, we have written. So it will produce opposite action. So the correct answer is B. It will produce opposite action, minus 1. Let's talk about physiological antagonism is found in. Now, physiological antagonists, answer is isoprenaline and salbutamol? The answer is no. Because isoprenoline is an agonist at beta receptor, it will stimulate beta receptor. Salbutamol is also a beta 2 agonist, so they are not antagonists. Isoprenoline and antagonist, the same answer is there. Isoprenoline and propranolol. Now, isoprenoline is a beta agonist, while propranolol is a beta blocker. It's a classical example of blocker word is coming, that is pharmacological antagonism. So beta blocker are generally competitive antagonists of beta receptor. Okay. Now adrenaline, remember, act on beta 2 receptor, produces bronchodilation. Histamine act on H1 receptor, produces bronchoconstriction. So opposite response, this is an example of physiological antagonist. Now salbutamol again act on beta 2 receptors, produces bronchodilation. Leukotriene act on LT1 receptor, act on, produces bronchoconstriction. Again, it's a classical example of physiological antagonism. Okay. So the answer for question number 6 is D and E. Now about inverse agonist, true statement is, we know that inverse agonist will bind to the same receptor binding site and it will produce, exert the action which is opposite. So try to find the word opposite whenever the word inverse agonist will come. Hence the answer is B. Okay. Hence the answer is B. Now antagonism between acetylcholine and atropine is, atropine, remember, is a competitive blocker of acetylcholine receptor, mainly muscarinic receptors. Now what is agonist? Agonist is, it has affinity and intrinsic activity of +1. Okay. So the answer is A. Now remember one point, when no type of agonist is mentioned, it always means full agonist. When no type of agonist is mentioned, it always means full agonist. So the answer is this one, A1. What about 0? It's a classical example of antagonist. What about -1? It's a classical example of inverse agonist. This is a classical example of full agonist. Remember, when nothing is mentioned, we assume this agonist always to be a full agonist. So the answer is A. Now, side effects of a drug arise due to interaction of a drug to molecules other than the target. These effects can be minimized by improving the specificity of a drug. Now, specificity is the power of a drug that by virtue of which it will bind to its own target only. If the drug is binding to other target also, the drug would be called as a non-specific drug. Okay. So the answer is specificity. Now two drugs have opposite action on different receptors. Opposite action, different receptor. The classical example is physiological antagonism. Okay. Which of the following is an example of physiological antagonism? We have already discussed prostacycline and thromboxane A2. Okay. Now, heparin and protamine is an example of chemical antagonism. Heparin is an acidic drug. Protamine is an example of a basic drug. They will interact with chemical bond. Physostigmine and acetylcholine, there is no antagonism in this. Adrenaline and phenoxybenzamine, it's an example of pharmacological blocker. They are an example of blockers. While prostacycline, remember, it inhibits platelet aggregation and produces vasodilatation by acting on its own receptor. Thromboxane A2 produces platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction, exactly opposite response. So they are the example of physiological antagonism, which we have already discussed. Now, side effect of a drug arise due to interaction of a drug to molecules other than the target. These effects can be minimized by increasing the specificity of a drug. A drug that competes for the active target or active binding site is known as competitive blocker. Okay. Partial agonist. Partial agonist will have low intrinsic activity and high affinity. Okay. So all agonists will have high affinity, but the effect will be produced as submaximal or low. Okay. When a drug binds to the receptor and causes opposite action, again opposite word is coming, mark the answer as inverse agonist. Which one of the following is true about competitive antagonism? Antagonism, competitive. We have to find a true statement. So if you talk about true statement about competitive antagonism, antagonism cannot be completely reversed by increasing the dose of agonist. This statement is false. It is rather completely surmountable. We have written a word surmountable. Yes, we can overcome the effect of a competitive blocker by increasing the dose of agonist. So effect is surmountable. An agonist cannot displace antagonist from the receptor. The answer is absolutely false, because most of the competitive antagonists, they bind to their receptor reversibly. Okay. Now, agonist and antagonist bind to the same receptor in cases of competitive. The answer is true. Dose response curve will shift towards the left in presence of competitive antagonist. The answer is false. Rather, it will shift to the right. So the answer is C. Okay. Okay. Now, what is dose response curve? That means, suppose you have given a dose of an agonist and you are seeing the response. So suppose you have given an agonist. Now, if you will add an antagonist, the response will reduce. Hence, we have to increase the dose of agonist to produce that same level of response. So we have to increase the dose. So there will be a parallel. You're right. There will be a parallel shift towards the right in cases of competitive antagonist in dose response curve. Okay. Now, acetazolamide is given to a patient of an angle closure glaucoma. It is a non-competitive inhibitor of carbonic. Which of the following will be reduced? So the answer for this question is decrease in Vmax. Now, the point is, we have already discussed that competitive antagonist and non-competitive antagonist. What happens to the maximum effect known as Vmax, and what happens to the dose of the required drug Km? Now, Vmax in cases of competitive antagonist becomes normal because we can overcome the effect. Km will be increased because the agonist will be requiring higher dose. While in non-competitive antagonist, the effect is non-surmountable. You can never produce that same level of effect ever again. It is reduced and there is no effect of increasing or decreasing the dose. So remember, in cases of competitive antagonist, Vmax will remain normal, Km increases. In non-competitive antagonist, the Vmax will decrease and Km will remain normal. So the answer is decrease in Vmax only in cases of non-competitive antagonist. Okay, so this is about your agonist and antagonist. Now let's talk about now dose response curve. So how and TDM, therapeutic drug monitoring. Now what do we mean by the word dose response curve? Dose response curve means, it's a very simple thing. Dose response curve. Now, dose response curve means, suppose you are giving a dose of a drug. Generally, we take the dose in log and we see the response. So instead of dose response curve, we write log dose response curve and we see the response. Generally, the drug will produce effect like this. The shape of dose response curve is sigmoid. Okay. Now, this dose response curve, remember, is of two type. This dose response curve is of two type. One is known as graded DRC, graded dose response curve. Second is known as quantile DRC, quantile dose response curve. Now in graded DRC, we check the response of a drug in one individual. And in quantile DRC, we check the response of a drug in percentage of population. That in how many people the drug will produce effect. In graded DRC, we find the efficacy of a drug and we find potency of a drug. While in quantile DRC, we find ED. ED stands for effective dose. Like ED50, effective dose in 50% of the individual. Similarly, toxic dose, known as TD50. And we compare when TD50 divided by ED50, it is known as therapeutic index. This therapeutic index, it tells us about the margin of safety. How much there is a safety margin between the toxic dose and effective dose. Okay. So these three things are measured in cases of quantile DRC. Efficacy and potency is measured in cases of DRC. Okay. Now, any drug which has a very low safety margin, if a therapeutic index ratio is very low, remember that drug requires monitoring. Okay, how we will be doing monitoring, that we will discuss shortly. Now let's come to what is efficacy. Efficacy means maximum effect produced by the drug. Maximum effect produced by the drug irrespective of dose. So suppose let's take an example. If a drug can decrease a BP from 200 to 100, that is a drug A. if there is a drug which can reduce BP from 200 to 100, there is a drug that can reduce BP 200 to 150 only. Which can produce more response, A or B? Can we say A can produce more response? So A is more efficacious than B. Okay, but if you write the dose, that this required 10 milligram of the dose, it requires 5 milligram of the dose. Can we say B requires less dose? So the drug which required lesser dose is caused to be more potent. So less dose means more potent drug. Okay, so potency determines the dose, how much dose is required to produce an effect, while efficacy means how much maximum effect a drug can produce. Okay, now remember, efficacy is always the determining factor. We always chose the drug on the basis of efficacy of a drug. Okay, and remember, this efficacy should not be confused with effective dose. Okay, because effective dose is the effect which is produced in percentage of people. So just pardon me. So let's talk about the question number one. Keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the question number one. A drug A in the dose of 10 milligram produces the same response or decrease in blood pressure as a drug B, 100 milligram of the drug B. So which of the following statement best describe this result? Can we say that drug A required lesser dose as compared to drug B? So can we say that the drug A is more potent than drug B? Okay, so the correct answer is B. Okay, B. Now drug A is more efficacious. The answer is false. They both are equally efficacious because they both can produce same response. They are equally efficacious. What about therapeutic index? Nothing, we cannot determine. Drug A is longer half-life, we cannot determine. So half-life is not determined in pharmacodynamics, it's rather determined in pharmacokinetics. Okay, now which of the following provides information about the variation in sensitivity to a drug in a population study? So the answer is quantal dose response curve. Okay, graded dose response curve tells us about in one population, one individual. Quantal in percentage of population. Therapeutic index is a margin of safety, TD50 upon ED50, and maximal efficacy means the maximum effect produced by the drug irrespective of the dose. Okay, maximum effect. Now which of the following provides information about the largest response a drug can produce regardless of dose? We know the answer. The answer is maximal efficacy. Now, ritonavir inhibits the metabolism of which of the following drugs except? Now, remember, ritonavir is actually a CYP3A4 inhibitor. So, it's a question of pharmacokinetic which is out here. But let's solve this question. And remember, all we have already discussed, all these drugs are the substrate of CYP3A4 except esmolol. So, the answer is esmolol. Now, a non-competitive inhibitor of enzyme, we have already discussed, non-competitive inhibitor reduces Vmax. Okay. Now, regarding efficacy and potency of a drug, all are true except. Okay. So, if you will draw a dose response curve, that is log dose and response, and suppose this is a drug A and this is a drug B. Now, what is efficacy? We have already discussed about efficacy is known as maximum effect or maximum response regardless of the dose. Can we say that A can produce more response as compared to B? Okay, can we say A can produce more response as compared to B? So can we say that A is more efficacious than B on this dose response curve? So can we say that efficacy on this dose response curve is determined on the basis of height of a graph? Okay, now the second term comes out to be potency. Now potency means that the dose required to produce 50% of effect. So suppose this is a drug C. Can we say that A will require, this is the 50% of the response, that A will require this much dose and C will require this much dose. Okay, now potency on a dose response curve is determined by the on the basis of left-sidedness. More it is left-sided, more it is more potent. Why? Because it will require less dose.
If a drug required lesser dose, it is known to be a more potent drug. Can we say that A will require less dose as compared to C? Hence, A is more potent than C. Okay, but A is equally efficacious as compared to C because the height of A and C is equal. But if you compare B and C, can we say efficacy of C is more than B because the height of C is more as compared to B? But B is more potent than C because B will require lesser dose as compared to C. Now remember, efficacy on dose response curve is denoted by a symbol known as Vmax, and potency on a dose response curve is denoted by a symbol Km. So this is known as Vmax of A, Vmax of C, this is known as Vmax of B. Now Km stands for potency, this is known as Km of A, Km of B, Km of C. Okay, so for more detailed conceptual revision, you can refer to the series part. Okay, so as we are discussing rapid revision out here, so sixth question is regarding efficacy and potency of a drug, all are true except in a clinical setup, efficacy is more important than potency. The answer is absolutely true. We always determine the choice of a drug on the basis of efficacy. In a log dose response curve, the height of a curve responds to efficacy. The answer is absolutely true. ED50 of a drug corresponds to efficacy. This is a false statement. ED50, we have already discussed, it is the effective dose in 50% of the individual. Drug that produce similar pharmacological effect can have different level of efficacy. The answer is absolutely true. As we can see, A can produce same response like B, but B can produce lesser response as compared to A. So the answer for this question is C. Now Michaelis-Menten constant is, now we know that Michaelis-Menten constant is Vmax and Km. Now the first question is concentration of the drug at which reaction velocity is half of the maximum. This is known as Km. The concentration of the drug at which the reaction velocity is maximum. Okay, this is known as Vmax. Okay, so the answer is both of the above. Now therapeutic monitoring of plasma of a drug is done when using all of the following except. Now let's talk about the concepts of therapeutic monitoring. Now the point is therapeutic monitoring or monitoring of a drug, let's revise one concept. Which drug require monitoring? The drug which require monitoring are drug are known as low safety margin. Okay, and these drugs are also known as narrow therapeutic index drug because therapeutic index is a margin of safety. Now we know that therapeutic index was TD50 upon ED50, and if this ratio is very low, can we say that effective dose of a drug and toxic dose of a drug is very near to each other? So in a little bit higher dose, the drug can produce harmful effect. So in this cases, we have to maintain the strict dose level of a drug in this therapeutic margin. And these drugs will require monitoring. Now there are two types of monitoring. In first case, we can easily measure the effect of a drug. If you can easily measure the effect of a drug, do that thing, do that monitoring. Like in cases of insulin, you can easily measure. We know that if we will little bit increase the dose of insulin, it will produce hypoglycemia. So you can see blood glucose sample. So we do monitoring in cases of insulin by regularly monitoring blood glucose level. Similarly with warfarin, we can do PT with INR, prothrombin time with INR. Similarly with heparin, we can do APTT test, anticoagulation. And similarly with clonidine and other antihypertensive drug, we can monitor BP. If a drug is antihypertensive, we can monitor BP. But there are certain drugs in which you cannot measure the effect of a drug. Let's say antidepressant, you cannot measure the mood of a drug. If you cannot measure the effect of a drug, then monitor the plasma concentration. Then monitor plasma concentration. And this type of monitoring is known as TDM. TDM stands for therapeutic drug monitoring. This is known as therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, And in this case, we will monitor the plasma concentration of a drug. The examples of the drug that required therapeutic drug monitoring, you can write a mnemonic DAT. You can write a mnemonic DAT, LAT, CM. D for digoxin. A for antiarrhythmic drugs, all antiarrhythmic drugs. A for, we can write anti-epileptic drugs like phenytoin, warfarin. T for the only anti-asthma drug that requires monitoring is theophylline. You'll write lithium, we cannot measure the mood. You'll write V, aminoglycosides, especially in cases of renal failure. You'll write TCA, TCA is tricyclic antidepressant. You'll write cyclosporin and tacrolimus, they are calcineurin inhibitors. And lastly, you will write methotrexate. Methotrexate is an anti-cancer drug, anti-cancer. In this cases, we cannot measure the effect of a drug. We will monitor the plasma concentration. This type of monitoring is known as TDM. That is therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. So these drugs are very unsafe drug. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see the question numbers. So the therapeutic monitoring of plasma level of a drug is done when using all of the following except. So you are measuring the plasma concentration. It is an example of aminoglycoside. Yes, we do therapeutic drug monitoring. Yes, TDM. Cyclosporin, yes. Phenytoin, anti-epileptic, yes. But what about warfarin? See, warfarin is an unsafe drug, but in cases of warfarin, we don't measure the plasma concentration. We can measure the effect of warfarin known as prothrombin time with INR, international normalized ratio. So the answer is warfarin. Now, therapeutic drug monitoring involves measurement of the plasma concentration to find whether the drug levels are within the therapeutic range or not. TDM to be clinically useful in following criteria. Now, let's see in which cases therapeutic drug monitoring is useful and in which cases we should not do therapeutic drug monitoring. So I'll just show you a slide and you can easily understand that in which cases we will be doing therapeutic drug monitoring. Now, therapeutic drug monitoring is done for the classes of drugs which are narrow therapeutic index drug. That means they are unsafe drug. This is the first indication, narrow therapeutic index. And we know we cannot measure the therapeutic effect or beneficial effect of a drug. Okay, like in case of lithium, digoxin, we cannot measure the effect. And the drug, the other prerequisite of doing therapeutic drug monitorings are, there should be a high individual variation in the plasma level. Nephrotoxic drug in renal failure, classically aminoglycoside, fourth point. Compliance of a drug, especially in cases of anti-epileptics like phenytoin, and in the cases of poisoning, we also do therapeutic drug monitoring. Now, therapeutic drug monitoring is not indicated in when the effect of a drug can be clinically determined, like insulin, antihypertensives, warfarin, heparin, we can measure the effect. Prodrugs, hit and run drugs. Now, prodrugs, why? Because prodrugs can be converted into various metabolites inside the blood. We cannot know, we don't know that which metabolite level we should measure in the plasma. Hit and run drug, they are not present in the plasma. They are permanently bound to their organ. So you will not find in the plasma. Or irreversible inhibitor, hit and run drugs are also known as irreversible inhibitors. So these are the conditions where therapeutic drug monitoring is not indicated. So keep this thing in mind. Let's solve the question number 9. So therapeutic drug monitoring to be clinically useful, this criteria should be fulfilled. So let's see the answer. Question number 9. A drug should be in good relation with plasma concentration. The answer is absolutely yes. The relationship. Okay. The relationship between plasma concentration and the therapeutic response should be poor. The answer is no. When pharmacodynamic tolerance is suspected, okay, the pharmacodynamic tolerance is suspected, the answer is no. Sorry, yes. When clinical response cannot be determined, yes. So in these cases, we must do therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, so the only criteria that is B, in B we should not do therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, so in A, C and D we must do therapeutic drug monitoring. So the answer is A, C, and D. Now, therapeutic index is a measure of, we know it's a measure of safety. It's a very important question, you must remember. Therapeutic, low, narrow therapeutic index for drug means low safety margin. So therapeutic index, which is TD50 upon ED50, is a measure of safety. It is known as therapeutic index. Therapeutic drug monitoring is required in all of the following except, we had already written anti-epileptic phenytoin, yes. Tacrolimus, cyclosporin, yes. Now metformin is a very safe drug. There is no requirement of monitoring in cases of metformin. Drugs having narrow therapeutic index drugs are lithium, yes. Phenytoin, yes. Tricyclic antidepressant, yes. Lithium. Antiepileptics like phenytoin. TCA like tricyclic antidepressant. Therapeutic drug monitoring is required for, the answer is again lithium. We had written. Therapeutic drug monitoring of plasma concentration of antihypertensive drug is not practiced. Why? Because we can easily measure the blood pressure of a patient. So the answer is, it's easier to measure the effect of these drugs. Okay. Now drug not having a narrow therapeutic index. The answer is sertraline. Now remember, sertraline is an SSRI. While these two drugs are TCA, tricyclic antidepressant, they are narrow therapeutic index drug. Lithium is also a narrow therapeutic index drug. SSRI are very safe drugs. Now, which of the following drug needs serum level monitoring or TDM, therapeutic drug monitoring? The answer we already know is lithium. Okay. Which of the following drug has narrow therapeutic range? The answer is phenytoin, anti-epileptic drugs. Now, therapeutic index is a measure of, assessment of margin of safety. We already know the ratio of dose that produces toxicity to the dose that produces clinical desired effect. So, toxic dose upon effective dose in a percentage of population is known as therapeutic index. Okay. Now, plasma drug monitoring is done for the drug with low safety margin or narrow therapeutic index drug. ED50 is the effect produced in 50% of the individual. Okay, so it tells us about, if you compare this TD50 upon ED50, it will come out to be therapeutic index, and therapeutic index is a margin of safety. It's a measure of safety, and ED50 is used for the measurement of safety of a drug. Okay, therapeutic index is a measure of safety. Efficacy of a drug refers to maximum response a drug can produce, D. We already know. Therapeutic index, again the same question, safety. Therapeutic index monitoring is done for all of the following. Metformin we don't do because metformin is a very safe drug. Okay.